Bible verse that we have read in the beginning has very important message for us. And I think we should read again these two Bible verses in Isaiah 41, 6 and 7. They helped everyone his neighbor, and everyone said to his brother, "Be of good courage." So the carpenter encouraged the goldsmith, and he that smoothed with hammer, him that smote the anvil, saying, "It is ready for the soldering." And he fastened it with nails that it should not be moved. In this Bible verses, we find the word that is not mentioned here, but we find the word cooperation. Everyone had to cooperate. Everyone should help his neighbor or his fellow man or anyone that is next to him. And not only helping him, but using word of encouragement, saying, "Be of good courage." Here, there are quite a few tradesmen and professionals mentioned. Carpenter, one is goldsmith, the other is only one that is holding the material with the thong. The other is one that has a hammer in his hand to hit the material on the anvil. And all of them were interdependent. They were the depending one from the other. If there would be no one to hit the material with the hammer, the work would not be done. If there would be no goldsmith to form the object, the work would not be done. And if they would discourage his fellow worker, then the work will not be done. But on the contrary, he was encouraging his fellow men. Now, who of these workers were the most important? Who of them were more important? There is no more important one than the other. All of them had their sphere of action, although some may have been professional in one thing, the other professional in another thing, but all of them were important to do the work. And when the work was done, they said, "Now it's ready. It's ready." And when it was ready, it was fastened, and it was fastened in such a way that it should not be moved. In the hymn that we sang, it says, "Help somebody today. Some has heavy loads. How will we help him if he has a heavy load? Climbing up on the top of his back or on the top of the burden, will that help him? How can we help someone that is discouraged? Coming to him with the words, 'Be of good cheer, be of good courage.' You know what? I want to sell you a car. And this car is loaded. And two important objects loaded in this car, which we will mention later. And this car is very old. I'm not going to tell you the brand of this car, but I'm going to read to you later. Do you want to buy it? You may say, Brother Sass, today is Sabbath day, how can you sell? Well, the way that I'm selling this, it's lawful to do it today. Amen. Because you are not going to pay anything for it. But better if you buy it. And, you know, this car has no motor in it. So, if that car has to go somewhere, you have to push it. And you have to push hard. Uphill, in the straight, or downhill, you have to push the car. And you know what? You have to push that car even across the river, across the sea. What would be that car? All right, let me read to you. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 3, 540 and 541. Volume 3, 540, 541. We should have a spirit of progress. Notice, we should have a spirit of progress. That means not to be stagnant in one place. We have to go ahead. We have to go forward. We must guard continually against being fixed in our views, feelings, and actions. The work of God is onward. Reforms must be carried on. And we must take hold and help move on the car of reform. What's the name of, what's the brand of that car?
Reform.
Car of reform. Okay, I'm going to talk about the car of reform. That we have to move forward. Has no engine, and we have to push many times uphill, and it's loaded. Energy tempered with patience and ambition and balanced by wisdom is now needed by every Christian. The work of saving souls is yet left to us, the disciples of Christ. Not one of us is excused. Many have become dwarfed and stunted in their Christian life because of inaction. We should employ all our time diligently while in this world. How earnestly should we improve every opportunity of doing good, of bringing others to a knowledge of the truth. Our motto should ever be onward, higher, surely, steadily, onward to duty, and to victory. So, would you like to buy this car? The car of reform, which is loaded, has no engine. You have to push it. And do you know what is loaded with? two main things: the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus is on one seat, and the other seat is the three angels' message. And this has to be pushed forward, uphill, downhill, in the plain, and even going across the sea, it has to go. Who should take part in moving forward the car of reform? Who should take part? It says here, not one of us is excused. But you know what happens sometimes? There may be some who, instead of pushing a car upward, he runs in front and pushes the car backwards, downhill, instead of pushing uphill. He counterworks the work of those that are pushing the car upward. By what means? Manuscript Releases, volume 17, page 315 says, I thank God for these words of encouragement in 2 Peter 1, 10 to 13. Why should we not all stop grumbling and putting stones in front of the wheels of the car of progress? How can we counteract the work of those that are pushing the car uphill? Perhaps not pushing it down. Perhaps it's not jumping on the top of it to make it heavier, but he may put some stones in front of the wheels. And what are these stones mentioned here? Grumbling. In Southern Watchman, September 4, 1902, Spirit of Prophecy says, one thing all can do. All can do one thing. What is it? They can avoid making the work of others unnecessarily hard by criticizing their efforts. Putting stones in front of the wheels of the car they are trying to push uphill. So what are these stones that many may put in front of the wheels? Criticism. Criticizing the efforts of others. If they are unwilling to help, to put their shoulder to the wheel, let them at least refrain from hindering those who are working. God calls for workers who will refuse to discourage their fellow workers. We are all engaged in the sacred duty of proclaiming the good news of salvation. Wherever we are, wherever we go, whomever we meet. And if we are inactive, that is already a hindrance. If we are inactive. But it's much worse if we, instead of putting our shoulders together with those that are pushing the car uphill, if we put stones in front of the wheel of the car, That's much worse. And what are those stones mentioned here? Criticism. Again, in Southern Watchman, same magazine, February 27, 1902. The hand of God, working through unseen agencies, has opened the way for the advancement of the work in the Southern field. You know, in the United States, the Southern field was very much abandoned. And the Spirit of Prophecy says that by God's providence, the work began there. But some of the many responsible positions have hindered the progress of this work. Throughout the field, there have been men who have put stones before instead of behind the wheel of the car. You know, when you go uphill, and those that are pushing, they get wearied. If someone has a stone and put immediately behind the wheel, that the car should not slide back, that's a great help. But it says they put stones in front instead of putting these stones behind to hold the car, not to slide it back. Throughout the field, there have been men who have put stones before instead of behind the wheel of the car that the workers are trying to push uphill. Unconverted men have brought forward theories and suggestions that have sown seeds of jealousy and evil surmising. Here are some other stones that can stop the car moving forward. What are they? Evil surmising and jealousy. The Lord can do without such men. The message He desired them to proclaim, He can give to the stones of the field to proclaim. This message will be given to the world, for prophecy has pointed out this work as one that must be accomplished. Why do some do all in their power to hinder? Such men would better go to some hard part of the field and begin to work. Well, this happens in God's work among those that were employed by the church. Some were pushing hard the work, others were pulling back. But even if some is not engaged full-time in the work of proclaiming the message, you know that he still can be a hindrance. I want to read a statement, and this is a very strong statement. Nevertheless, I'm going to read it. It's from Signs of the Times, September 4, 1879. Signs of the Times, September 4, 1879. There are in our churches those who profess the truth, who are only hindrances to the work of reform. In our churches, there are those that are hindrances to the work of reform. Hindrances to push forward the car of reform. They are clogs to the wheel of the car of salvation. This class are frequently in trial. Doubts, jealousies, suspicion are the fruit of selfishness. and seem to be interwoven with their very natures. Here there are some more clogs, some more stones. Spirit of prophecy mentioned this. Doubts, jealousies, suspicion, selfishness. And these things are a part of their own nature. They are interwoven with their very nature. I shall name this class chronic church grumblers. They do more harm in a church than two ministers can undo. They are a text to the church and a great weight to the ministers of Christ. They live in an atmosphere of doubts, jealousies, and surmisings. Much time and labor of the ambassadors of Christ are required to undo their work of evil and restore harmony and union in the church. This takes from the courage and strength of God's servants and unfits them for the work He has for them to do in saving perishing souls from ruin. God will reward these troublers of Zion according to their works. The ministers of Christ should take their position and not be hindered in their work by these agents of Satan. There will be enough of these to question, to quibble, to criticize, to keep the ministers of God constantly busy, if they will allow themselves to be detained from the great work of giving the last saving message of warning to the world. If the church has no strength to stand against unsanctified, rebellious feelings of church grumblers, it is better to let church and grumblers go overboard together than lose the opportunity of saving hundreds who would make better churches and have the elements existing within themselves of strength and union and power. Unfortunately, in some places, there are such elements, chronic church grumblers. And they have all these evil traits of character. They live in an atmosphere of doubt, jealousy, and evil surmisings. And the servants of God, they have to stop pushing forward the car of reform to come and settle problems because of these church grumblers. And the spirit of prophecy says, if the church has no strength to withstand them and correct them, then let the church and the grumblers go overboard together. I remember in one country, I was sent to organize one local church. But that church was known as the theological seminary of the country, because everybody of them, they were like a little seminarist. They knew everything, and they started discussing among themselves, and they create a tremendous problem in that church. There were not two persons that were in peace, one with the other. And when I saw that situation, I told them, brethren, I came here to organize you as a church, but I will not. You solve your problems, make peace among yourselves, and after, I will come back to organize you. And one sister said to me, brother, you want to throw us overboard. She knew the statement here. I said, I don't want to throw you overboard, but if you do not correct, that's what we have to do. We will not come back to this church. But thank God that two of the main troublemakers moved away, and the problem was solved. Then we went there and we organized the church. This is what the spirit of prophecy says, that we should not endorse those that put clogs in front of the wheel of salvation. There are many important statements in the spirit of prophecy. But suppose one is not stopping the advancement of the work. One does not put any stone in front of the wheel. He is not pushing downward the car. He does not jump up on the top of the car that he also should be pushed. He does not do any of those things. But he stands still. He does not help pushing the car forward. You know, in the time of the children of Israel, there was a city called Meroz. And in the book of Judges, chapter 5, verse 23, we read about Meroz. Curse ye Meroz. Judges 5:23. Curse ye Meroz, said the angel of the Lord. Curse ye bitterly the inhabitants thereof, because they came not to the help of the Lord, to the help of the Lord against the mighty. They did not come to help. And for that reason, the city was cursed. And the spirit of prophecy says, volume 2, Testimonies for the Church, page 247. Volume 2, 427. What was the sin of Meroz? Doing nothing. That was a sin. Doing nothing when they should help. And when they did nothing, that was a sin for which the city was cursed. It was not because of great crimes that they were condemned, but because they did not come up to the help of the Lord. When the energy of all were needed to help, they just crossed their arms and were doing nothing, did not help. And the angel of the Lord says, curse the city. Spirit of prophecy says, this was not a crime that they have committed. No. But their sin was doing nothing. And you know, if we stop and we do nothing, you know what happens to us? We become spiritually dwarfs. We do not grow. Others will grow, others will advance, and we are left behind if we do nothing. Signs of the Times, October 28, 1897, another statement about this Meroz. It says, curse ye Meroz, said the angel of the Lord. Curse ye bitterly the inhabitants thereof, because they came not to the help of the Lord against the mighty. These words mean much to those who have no spirit to labor. no desire to wear the yoke or lift the burdens in the service of Christ. There are many who do nothing. On the contrary, they are clogs, or they put stones in front of the wheel. Now, those that are inactive in the service of Christ, helping somebody in his need, and the needs may be varied. The need may be spiritual need, maybe emotional need, maybe physical need, maybe a little help work that the person needs. And those who are inactive do not engage themselves in the service of Christ, in helping somebody. They are hindrances. And this is valid also in the family. In the family, everyone should help. Children should help the parents. Yes, husband should help the wife. The wife should help the husband. Should have cooperation. Help somebody. Help someone that is in need. Because if we do that, we will be strengthened ourselves. You remember the experience of the man that gave up all hopes of survival in the snow. And he could not go ahead. He gave up the hope. And when he decided, well, let me die here, he heard somebody that was groaning. And so, oh, there is somebody else there. Let me help him. And he stood up and went and helped and saved the other one and saved himself. If we help others, we are helping our own selves. Therefore, let's not forget the Bible verse we have read before. Everyone helped his neighbor and said, be of good courage. And when the work is done, not one nor the other, but all of them receive the credit. And the work is done, they fix it, that it should not be moved. This is our duty, dear brethren, to help whomever we can, wherever we are, in spiritual sense, physical sense, emotional, or any other sense. We should help. And who will be helped?
Ourselves.
Our own selves. May the Lord bless us and help us, that we may keep in mind these words. My wish and prayer. Amen. Our gracious, merciful Heavenly Father, we come before Thy presence in the precious name of Jesus with thankful hearts, because Thou hast given us health, strength, life, and also the hope of salvation. We thank Thee for the plan that was outlined, so that one day we may be found as Thy children in Thy kingdom. We ask Thee to help us, that we may be a help to those that are around us. And by helping them, we also may be helped. We ask Thee to forgive us wherever we failed in the past, and teach us what to do and how to do the work for Thee in helping others. We ask it to bless each one of us here present. Bless thy people everywhere in the world. Bless thy servants who have responsibilities in the church today, that they may fulfill their duties faithfully. And we ask thee now to forgive us our sins, mistakes, and shortcomings. Wash us in the precious blood of Jesus, and give us thy peace in our hearts. Dismiss us from this meeting with thy peace and the Sabbath blessings, and continue with us in the remaining hours of this day, that we may keep it holy. We ask all these mercies and thank thee in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.